My name is Elise Higley. I'm a local farmer and also the director of Our Family Farms Coalition. How many of you know about GMO-free Jackson County?
Woo!
Right? Nice. So you know that the work they did for the last 2 years, so many dedicated individuals here tonight, are the reason that Our Family Farms Coalition came together and the reason that you're all here and have the ability to vote on this important measure to support family farms and to stop the cultivation of genetically engineered crops in our valley. So one, I just want to say thank you so much to Chris Hardy and Anna and Christina and Barbara, if she's here, and Brian and all the other people and all of you probably who signed on to that to make this opportunity happen for us this May. So this January, a group of farmers really decided to activate and let the community know how this measure affects family farms. And that's what we've been doing. I have the honor of representing almost 170 farms now in the Rogue Valley, and I feel that huge responsibility, and I take it very seriously, and I want you to know that we are just doing an amazing job right now getting the word out to people, but we definitely need all of your help. We're going to talk a little bit about that, but I also want you to know that to be able to feel comfortable enough to talk about this measure and really spread that knowledge to your friends, each person you talk about, maybe even not your friends, your neighbors, to get out canvassing. We know that there's almost $1 million against this campaign to filled with untruths and unjust statements, and we want you to feel comfortable enough to talk about why there's going to be no cost. We can look at the biggest thing is that this is the county's discretion whether to enforce this or not. And we know from other counties that there has been no other cost, if not minimal cost in other counties. We know the benefits of the economic boost this will have in our economy. We can look at Marin County, 700 times the percent of sales, right? This is what we want to see happening in our valley. We want to see good food being grown here. We want to see diversity in crops. We want to be able to grow our seeds. We can look at the map in the back and know that this valley is too small and narrow. So if you get someone who thinks they might agree with genetically engineered crops, it may just not be right for this valley. So let's agree on that. It's not right for the Rogue Valley, and we want it out. And so we want to just get you all activated and get a chance to be able to spread the word to other people. We're working from Rogue River through Ashland. And yes, Ashland still needs people educated. We still need to get people registered to vote, and we need your help doing that.
Do you want to talk about the volunteer stuff a little bit? Or?
Well, so I didn't know what. we have clipboards right here. We are canvassing almost every day of the week. We have training Tuesday, Thursdays, and Saturdays in Ashland office and in the Medford office. So we have clipboards tonight to sign you up to canvass. That means going door to door. You get a training. Once you're trained and you have the messaging, you can really do that at your own schedule. But we need to make sure that people are clear on the message and that they're able to articulate themselves well about the measure itself. And we also, if canvassing isn't, you know, what you feel like you're comfortable with, we have phone banking, we have sign waving, we have everything you can think of, we have the need for. We have, you know, data entry work, and if you don't have time for that, this is really the time to reach into your pocketbook and get, when you're upset about those commercials or those ads that are on TV, then, or on the radio, this is your chance to combat that.
Adelita San Vicente Tello, she has been like 10 years in the movement against GMO corn in Mexico. She is the leader of a coalition that is called Sin Maíz No Hay País, and she represents over 300 organizations, some of them with farmers, concerned scientists in Mexico, different kind of people, and she's gonna tell you what they have been doing. That is amazing, and I am very honored to be here because in the U.S. this is the battlefield now. We should be supporting you here because depending on what happens here is what's going to happen in the state level, in the leveling campaign, the I-27, and also in other states. So this is the future of the movement in the U.S. and it's starting here, and it's why we are here today, and it's why we invite Adelita San Vicente Tello, because you're going to feel inspired with her work, and we feel very inspired with your work also. And it's very important to start right here in your own house, supporting the global movement. So, Adelita, 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 Adelita.
Muchísimas gracias. Verdaderamente es un honor estar aquí en esta importante lucha.
Good evening. It is a great pleasure and an honor to be here for this very important struggle.
Creo que la lucha en el corazón de Estados Unidos.
I believe that the struggle in the heart of the United States.
Es muy importante para todo el mundo.
It's extremely important for the rest of the world.
Lo que ustedes hacen aquí adentro en Estados Unidos tendrá una gran relevancia en todo el mundo.
For what you're doing here within the United States will have an incredible impact on the rest of the world.
Y me siento profundamente honrada de ser invitada y de ser parte de esta lucha que estoy segura que ganaremos todos.
So I'm proud to be invited to be a speaker on this front of the battle that we're all fighting, that I'm sure we're going to win.
Es para mí también un honor que el Dr. Chapela me traduzca.
That is a reference to her translator, myself, Ignacio Chapela.
Verdaderamente es un traductor con varios posgrados y doctorados.
He's an expensive translator. Some degrees and positions.
Y bueno, creo que hemos hecho muy buena pareja porque él traduce, pero incrementa y aumenta sus grandes conocimientos a lo que yo digo.
We seem to have found some magic to this relationship since yesterday when we started this Dog and Pony show here for you, I try to translate, but also try to embellish and make myself good, look good in the process.
Porque verdaderamente en esta lucha que tenemos en México y en el mundo, tenemos científicos honestos como el Dr. Chapela.
Hey, can we not get personal about this? Because she says, in this struggle, we do have scientists who are honest
y comprometidos
and committed
con que los conocimientos que han adquirido a lo largo de su vida sirvan para la humanidad y no sirvan para hacer negocio. Yes.
To make the knowledge that they have accumulated over a lifetime of use to humanity and not to business.
Y uno de ellos es el doctor Ignacio Chapela, que hoy
Ignacio
tengo el honor que me traduzca. Como dijo Miguel, el doctor Chapela descubrió la contaminación de maíces nativos en México en 2001.
In 2001, the laboratory under my guidance, mostly run by indigenous people from southern Mexico in Oaxaca, made the discovery of the presence of transgenic materials in their native land races of corn.
Y eso fue muy importante, y yo creo que él puede hablar un poquito de ello.
And Adelita believes that was very important and that I should say a couple of words. Not more than that, because I think you're all aware. And you learned in kindergarten about the birds and the bees. And you learned about the wind carrying pollen and how plants get pollinated. This story needs to be told to people in towns and cities, but not in places where people farm, where people at least have gardens and they know how seeds are formed. In some places like the University of California at Berkeley, the main editor of California Agriculture, which is the main magazine that puts out information for farmers in California and therefore in the world, once called me and she said, Ignacio, I have a question on the phone. I have a question. There's this really troubling development about the Cartagena Protocol, where people in the international scene, they are talking about what plants should cross borders, international borders. And they're saying that, of course, some ornamental plants should be regulated, that some seedlings should be regulated, or and so on and so forth. But they're talking about seeds. I thought this protocol was about living things, and seeds are not alive, right? So this is the level of ignorance that I am used to deal with within the university as well as other places in the urban environment. It's really nice to see that here we don't need to belabor the reality that cross-pollination is real, that it happens, that wind carries pollen, that insects and birds and so on carry pollen, and that contamination is a reality, biological reality, that it's not a question of whether, but when cross-pollination will happen. And it's exactly the problem, I think, the biological problem that we're engaged with in your campaign, because some people will claim that coexistence is possible, where we know and we have demonstrated with actual physical evidence that even in the remote mountains of Oaxaca in southern Mexico, thousands of miles away from the nearest legally planted transgenic crop, cornfield, you have cross-pollination, you have contamination. So the question of coexistence is a red herring that was invented to try and convince you that this is something that will not happen.
Thank
How is
you.
That for translation?
It's a very good translation. Es muy buen traductor. Me complementa muy bien. Yo voy a hablar un poco de lo que estamos haciendo en México, de esta lucha por el maíz que hemos hecho en México, y voy a permitirme introducir un poco por qué creemos que esta lucha por el maíz es una disputa, por qué creemos que el maíz está en nuestro corazón. En el caso de México.
I would like to talk to you a little bit about our struggle in Mexico and why it is that we believe that it is a struggle and why and how it is that corn is really at the heart of our culture.
Bueno, para empezar, esto que es tan importante y que ustedes lo saben muy bien en esta zona de Estados Unidos que me ha gustado mucho conocer. Como la agricultura es uno de los tres inventos más importantes de la humanidad y que tiene pues más de 10,000 años de desarrollo.
As you all know, I don't need to tell you here, agriculture is one of the most important inventions of humanity, and there are at least 10,000 years of development of this in the most important cultures.
Y solo en el último tramo, como ustedes lo logran ver, en una pequeña fracción de tiempo, es que está la revolución industrial, la revolución verde, perdón, y la revolución que le han llamado de la biotecnología moderna, en que las semillas dejaron de ser un bien de la comunidad para convertirse en una mercancía.
And it is only in the last sliver of time in this history, this long history, that we have the arrival of this concept of the Green Revolution, and then later even the biotech revolution, which, if nothing else, what they have done is that they have all of a sudden transformed something that used to be a common good into a commodity.
Y bueno, para nosotros es muy importante remarcar esto que Vavilov dijo el siglo pasado, en que existen 8 centros de origen de las especies y de la agricultura en el mundo. Uno de ellos es Mesoamérica, que incluye México y Centroamérica.
From the late 19th century, and especially through the work of this botanist and biogeographer in Russia, Vavilov, we know that there are centers where most of the diversity and origin of the crops that humanity depends on have arisen. In this case, 8 of these centers are highlighted.
In Mesoamerica?
In the Americas, very importantly, we have the Mesoamerican Center of Origin and Diversification of Crops, which is running from northern Nicaragua to, it all depends on how you look, certain large parts of the U.S., and the Andean region.
Y bueno, esta posibilidad del desarrollo de la agricultura va ligado al desarrollo de la biodiversidad, que se expresa en esta conjunción
entre la diversidad biológica y la diversidad cultural.
And what is important about these centers of biodiversity, since we are speaking where we stand in a center of biological diversity, a hotspot of biological diversity, the Klamath Knot is a center of biological diversity, but it does not have the other element to it, which is the element of cultural diversity, which is the two elements that you have to have the generation of diversity that is useful for humans. So these centers have the conjunction of both biological as well as cultural diversity.
Y en esta lámina vemos la conjunción entre los países con megadiversidad medida en plantas vasculares y diversidad cultural medida en lenguas.
So here you see on the right hand side the measure of biological diversity for these different countries. Measured as the number of vascular plants that you find in those countries, and on the left you see a table of the cultural diversity as measured by the number of languages in these countries.
Y en el centro, o sea, los países con mayor riqueza biocultural, encontramos a China, Indonesia, México.
Where you find the most overlap between these two diversities is in China, Indonesia, and Mexico.
Y de esta manera consideramos que la biodiversidad no está sola. La biodiversidad está unida a estas grandes culturas y como ustedes logran ver en esta fotografía, nosotros hablamos de la agrobiodiversidad que es un producto del conocimiento ancestral de los agroecosistemas y de la diversidad local.
From our point of view, biodiversity is not, doesn't come by itself, but it really is carried by people. And here you see biodiversity expressed in a very clear and simple graphical way by the conjunction of human as well as biological resources.
Esta foto es en Chiapas, México, y tiene en la parte de arriba eso es un banco de semillas, donde los campesinos año con año guardan las semillas que sembrarán. Abajo tienen la cosecha de la cual comen. Y es un sistema que ellos año con año recrean en los que recrean la biodiversidad.
What you see here is a family in Chiapas, the southern state of Mexico, that is holding their literally holding above their heads, being protected or being held by the biological diversity in a bank. It's a seed bank that contains the selected seeds that they will use for future plantings. Above them. And below, the diversity or the biomass that they will consume, that they will use as for that year.
Y bueno, en México seguimos teniendo una gran cantidad de territorios en donde está la población indígena resguardando estos conocimientos, esta riqueza biológica.
And what is still there in Mexico is the territorial domain of many indigenous people who are still there and cover really the breadth and the width of the country.
Calculamos que 13% de los mexicanos son indígenas.
About 13% of Mexicans identify as indigenous.
Y bueno. Esta gran agrobiodiversidad posibilitó que en México se desarrollara todas estas plantas, toda esta conjunción de plantas que hoy representan cerca del 16% de lo que consume la humanidad.
And those people have been responsible for bringing into domestication and into human use many many different species, not only corn, not only beans, not only squash, but all those different species and more, up to the point where a good estimate is of about 15 to 16% of the products that are consumed by humanity having arisen from this Mesoamerican center of diversification.
En el centro de estas plantas tenemos al maíz. Que el maíz para nosotros es una, pues como lo dice Bonfil Batalla, es un invento de nosotros y a la vez nos inventó a los mexicanos y a la cultura mexicana.
And the backbone of all this diversity, that what holds it all together, is corn. In the words of Guillermo Bonfil Batalla, who is an anthropologist, a very important, influential, and deep-thinking anthropologist of all these things, he says, corn is an invention of humans in this area, but it's also what invented humans in this area.
Y este gran invento significa que de una planta muy sencilla, que un pasto que es el tío simple, pasamos al maíz.
And there is a magic step in this, of course. There's something that is, even by geneticists and biologists, still not understood, how it was possible to make a dramatic, catastrophic jump from the plant on your left, which is a grass with a very funny kind of seed that shatters and goes away, to the edible and usable corn on the right, where the seeds stay in the corn cob and produces this monstrous amount of seeds that are available for human use. This jump happens in a catastrophic one-time event in very specific places, geographically speaking, in Mexico.
Este gran milagro que fue la producción de maíz ha tenido un éxito a lo largo de 8,000 años que le ha permitido, después de la conquista española, salir y adaptarse en diversas condiciones, desde el norte del continente hasta Argentina, desde Sudáfrica hasta Europa.
So this miracle that happened about 10,000 years ago has given a history that reaches all the way to the contact with European people. Before they arrived, corn had already adapted, because it has this amazing adaptability and flexibility, to very different regions from northern to South America. But also when the Spaniards come, it really opens a floodgate into the world. It can grow also from sea to 3,000 meters.
¿Y esta gran plasticidad?
So I get to talk about this graph, which is cool. The diversity of corn, of course, people have studied it in many ways, and there is the natural tendency to try and find races, groups that are consistent within themselves. So there are, depending on who you ask, and the number is continuously varying, but something between 50 and 60 different races, so-called races of corn, which are not to be confused with the land races, which are the different varieties that are kept in specific ecological conditions. And there are thousands and thousands of those. But of the 50 to 60 or 65 different races, this is a graphic example of why it is important to have these different races and varieties, because each one of them can be adapted, can be responsive and useful under very different environmental conditions. These are two very simple examples: altitudinal adaptability, as well as adaptability to different precipitation levels, you know, rain patterns. And you can see that different races here have different patterns of adaptability to each one of these. So corn in general is incredibly plastic, genetically and eco-physiologically plastic.
Y es por ello que es el cultivo ideal para el cambio climático.
Being the ideal crop for confronting any change, including climate change.
Sin ningún transgénico, por él mismo es el cultivo ideal.
By itself, it's a plastic organism.
En México, la agricultura campesina tiene una gran importancia, y no solo nos provee de alimentos, sino nos provee de agua, de oxígeno, de recursos naturales, de conocimiento, de cultura. Y bueno, es una agricultura que se desarrolla en condiciones muy diversas, muy diferentes a las que suceden en Estados Unidos, como vemos aquí, que es la Sierra Norte de Veracruz, donde crece maíz, plátano, el río está abajo.
Adelita is trying to highlight here the contrast between growing corn in the United States for commodity crops and biomass, biofuels, and so on. And the way this plant really has existed for over 9,000 years, 10,000 years really, until the advent of industrial agriculture. And here you see the corn plants being grown in a context, the context of the milpa, which is an agroecological system that contains many different species, held together by corn, of course, but that contain all kinds of things. In this particular case, you see corn being grown together with bananas, and here all these things that for an industrial agriculturalist in the US might look like weeds, containing a huge number of useful plants, medicinal plants, ritual plants, edible plants in all kinds of different forms, and so on. Oh, there's a picture missing there.
En México los campesinos están constantemente, cada ciclo que siembran, que generalmente siembran dos ciclos al año, ellos están mejorando las condiciones de siembra, están observando y mejorando sus variedades, por lo cual hablamos de que México es un centro no solo de origen, sino de diversificación constante.
The diversification that comes out of Mexico is not simply random or just happening by happenstance. There is a huge amount of experimentation and observation and continuous challenge of the corn plants to different conditions. So the accumulated experimental intervention on this plant over the millennia is really what is coming out of this, and is really the source of this diversity. Maybe we can try to go back and forth with the slide to see if we can retrieve that photo. Can you come forward now? Okay.
Y las mujeres en esta conjunción tienen un papel muy importante, conservando las semillas, determinando las variedades que requieren de acuerdo a las necesidades de producción en la cocina.
So while men do a lot of the work out in the fields, women have a very important role in choosing, selecting, and making very important decisions in what gets carried over generations.
Este es un patrimonio cultural que para nosotros debe ser revalorado para mantener el maíz y la producción de maíz en el mundo.
So the cultural heritage as an informatic asset is something that we believe is something that needs to be revalued, as I believe your participation in the maintenance and generation of seed as an informatic asset is really undervalued in all these discussions. You guys are told that you are producing biomass, not informatic assets, which is, I think, what you produce as a seed producing county and state.
En estas unidades son un reservorio genético único en el mundo.
So these places in Mexico, as the Rogue Valley, I would say, are incredibly important reservoirs of genetic diversity and materials that are in continuous change through cultural practices.
Oops.
Oops.
A ver la que sigue. The next, please.
Next slide, please.
Ah, it's finished. Oh my gosh.
I remember what happened last night. I know the rest of the slides.
Oh no. I'm so sorry.
Adelita, could we return to the other presentation from last night?
Por favor, Ashman, the other. Thanks. Yo traté de hacer dos presentaciones en
una. I tried to tailor tonight's presentation to fit what I felt this was happening here.
Yes.
But we're heading back to the presentation from last time.
No, está bien, it's good. At the beginning, please. Bueno, para acabar la anterior idea, lo que nosotros queremos decir es que toda esta riqueza que pasa en el campo mexicano está en peligro.
Simply to round up the previous idea is to say that I would like to say that we recognize there's huge richness in this heritage, and it's a heritage that is at risk.
Y que esta riqueza está en peligro, está en una disputa por las grandes compañías como Monsanto, por toda esta riqueza que significa el maíz.
So there is a contest going on over this richness, over this heritage.
Las siguientes láminas que me faltaron presentan cómo el maíz es hoy el cereal que más volumen de producción tiene en el mundo.
In the slides that I'm missing there, I wanted to simply make the point that how important corn is as the most important crop, internationally speaking, globally speaking.
Y cómo el maíz hoy se ha convertido en el segundo producto después del petróleo que más se utiliza, no solo para producir alimentos, sino para producir papel, para producir medicinas y para producir agrocombustibles.
And I also wanted to make the point that of how corn has catapulted beyond the use as simple food, and it's being now used as the most important raw material, second only to oil, for the production of pharmaceuticals, paper, plastic, and all kinds of products. I think you guys know all about that.
Excuse me. More. No, ah, es okay. La otra. No importa.
¿Quieres la de los
muebles políticos? No, déjalo. Okay. Excuse me. Perdón.
Va a ser lo mismo.
Sí, aquí está. El maíz es el cereal con mayor
volumen
de producción.
This is simply volume of production by ton.
Más que el arroz y que el trigo.
And it's above rice and wheat.
Y esto se explica por su uso para producir la siguiente.
Next slide, please.
Yes. Para producir todas estas cosas, no solo alimentos, sino papel, medicamentos y los agrocombustibles.
So these are all the very different products that are used, that are made from corn, that don't look anything like corn.
Y aquí lo que queremos mostrar es que a pesar de que la soya es el cultivo transgénico con mayor producción en el mundo, el maíz es el segundo, es en el maíz donde existe el mayor número de eventos de modificación genética y no en la soya.
So curiously, it is in corn where most of the transgenic or GMO manipulations have taken place. There you see 35 different events of manipulation of corn, even though corn is not as important in terms of acreage as soybean would be. So most of the effort to introduce GMOs has gone to corn rather than other crops.
En México, las solicitudes de siembra de maíz transgénico, la mayor parte están en manos de Monsanto.
And most of the interventions, most of the attempts at transforming corn through GMO manipulation, transgenic manipulation, come from Monsanto's house, even though all the others are also from large corporations.
Entonces, bueno, nosotros desde 2007, preocupados por esta situación y por esta hipótesis de que México, como centro de origen y de diversificación del maíz, sería un gran trofeo para Monsanto, estamos en una lucha por defender la agricultura campesina y a nuestro maíz.
So we are very clear, and since 2007 we have a campaign in which we are very clear that Mexico would be a fantastic trophy for Monsanto to claim. I could say the Rogue Valley has that quality too.
Yeah.
you guys are particularly special, and claiming that you guys came down would be very, very important for them to say. What she's been saying.
Creo que vamos a hacer otro cambio.
Apparently there's going to be another presentation.
Another presentation. Porque quiero platicarles un poquito lo que.
I would like to tell you something else.
Si no están muy cansados, platicarle un poquito lo que hemos hecho como campaña Sin Maíz No Hay País.
I would like to tell you about the response that we have brought up against this challenge. In this struggle.
Perfecto. Perfecto.
So what are we doing about?
Sí, hemos formamos esta campaña que se llama Sin Maíz No Hay País desde 2007. La siguiente, en que pensamos como ustedes aquí en Oregon están luchando por salvar la agricultura. Pensamos que la agricultura la que sigue era muy importante para salvar al propio país.
So the name of the campaign is Sin Maíz No Hay País, which means without corn there is no country. And the intent of it is to say that there is no country without agriculture. So the campaign is really to save agriculture in the country in order to save the country.
Iniciamos en 2007, que era un año muy importante para la negociación del Tratado de Libre Comercio, porque era el fin de la regularización de los productos sensibles que son el maíz, el frijol y el azúcar.
So 2007 is an important date for Mexico and for the US because it is the year when all the tariffs were removed finally after the grandfathering of tariffs that were coming into NAFTA. By 2007, those tariffs are removed. So it is the moment where NAFTA becomes completely active.
Y en un primer momento pensamos en llamar la atención al gobierno mexicano y frente a Obama de que se hiciera una renegociación del capítulo agropecuario del Tratado de Libre Comercio.
So our first thought was that we were going to try and accomplish a renegotiating of the agriculture chapter of NAFTA.
Y nosotros hicimos muchas cosas para, como una gran campaña para llamar la atención sobre ello. Sembramos maíz en el Zócalo y en plazas públicas.
So our campaigns are very public, are very very active and very visible. They plant corn and milpas, that means a variety of plants associated with corn, in key open public spaces, for example, the Central Square in Mexico City.
Con artistas muy famosos.
The famous artists come with us.
The next, hicimos un gran tianguis, un gran mercado en el Zócalo.
We took over the Central Square in Mexico City and established a tianguis, which I intended to translate as a farmer's market, except that it is a farmer's market that has been going on for 10,000 years in the countryside. So they basically brought it into the city from the places where it is actually active and made it really visible.
La que sigue. Hicimos un gran concierto en la ciudad.
A great spectacular concert. I don't know, rock music?
Yes. Tratando de llamar la atención de los jóvenes y de la gente urbana.
Trying to bridge the gap to young people and to urban people.
Nosotros decíamos, sin maíz no hay país, pon a México en tu boca. Queriendo llamar la atención de que en cada acto de comer estábamos desarrollando un acto político.
Sin maíz no hay país, without corn there is no country, has a subtitle and it says put your country in your mouth.
El acto político, de que en cada bocado tú estás haciendo un acto político.
With the recognition that every time you use your mouth, and I would say both to eat as well as to speak, you are doing a political act.
Una idea que tomamos de la película. realmente es una idea que tomamos de la película Comida S.A.
The idea started from the American movie Food Inc. So you see the work that happens here reprocessed through the mind and culture of people in Mexico and coming back now to feed back to this culture. It's fantastic.
Simbólicamente cerramos la frontera el 1 de enero de 2008.
We closed the border with the U.S. in a symbolic way on January the 1st of 2008.
La que sigue. Hicimos una gran marcha.
There was a great march on Mexico City.
La que sigue. Entregamos firmas a los senadores de la República.
We brought massive numbers of signatures to the senators of the country.
Pero el gobierno mexicano no nos escuchó.
But the Mexican government did not listen. And this cartoon has the Mexican president down at the bottom, really dwarfed by his bosses from the different corporations. And you should know that Mexico is not anywhere near as balanced as the United States is balanced in terms of power. And you know that the United States is very balanced, right?
Right.
And so Mexico is even worse in the sense that the executive branch has basically the dictatorial powers. So the fact that the president is cool with all these corporations against all these votes, all these signatures, and all these people on the streets is very significant.
Y bueno, el gobierno mexicano no nos tomó en cuenta, pero a la fecha nosotros consideramos que México vive una emergencia alimentaria. En México, desde que se firmó el Tratado de Libre Comercio, el hambre ha crecido y la obesidad ha crecido hasta el 70% de la población.
But whatever the government might think, we continue to be convinced that Mexico is living through a food and food economy and environmental emergency or crisis, based on very simple statistics that are undeniable. Number one, that hunger continues to rise. 19 million people go hungry, while at the same time 70% of the population is obese.
Esto es terrible. Y crece. La que sigue. Entonces nosotros decidimos tratar de tomar por nuestra parte este problema de la alimentación. Y bueno, una de las cosas que hemos hecho es poner al maíz, empezar a desarrollar un ritos alrededor del maíz, como es este Día Nacional del Maíz.
Right, so we did not give up. We decided to continue our campaign and to start building concepts and even rituals around corn. One of them is the consecration of September 29th as the Day of Corn, that started first in the countryside in small little towns, then in Mexico City, and now it has really spread throughout the country and anywhere outside the world where there are people of corn.
Aquí hay algunas
representaciones. So this is National Day of Corn.
La que sigue, llamamos por la, el maíz y la libertad.
Corn and freedom is being sought.
Y a partir del 2009 también decidimos tomar la justicia en nuestras manos. Este es un concepto difícil que ayer tratábamos de explicar, pero que significa no solo pedirle al gobierno que nos respete, sino exigir que se cumpla con los derechos que tenemos, nuestro derecho a la alimentación sana y suficiente, a un medio ambiente y al uso de la biodiversidad, por
ejemplo. Since 2009, this concept, that is a complex concept that we've been struggling since last night, Adelita first brought it up, to translate, came up. This concept of justiciability is a concept that implies not to recognize that the fact that you have rights doesn't mean much. that rights cannot be static, that you have to exercise and act the acts to make justice. So basically, that you have to make justice rather than expect to receive it.
Yes. Y que también tiene que ver con el uso de la biodiversidad y lo que dijo
con básicamente el derecho a un medio ambiente sano, a una alimentación sana y suficiente y al uso de la biodiversidad.
So in this case, this concept is being used to enact a healthy environment, a healthy food, healthy and sufficient food, and the what's considered to be a basic human right to access and enjoy biodiversity.
En el caso de los transgénicos, nosotros encontramos que los permisos que había dado el gobierno de México para la siembra experimental y piloto de maíz transgénico eran ilegales.
So by this point, the Mexican government had already authorized the planting, open field planting of transgenic GMO corn for experimental and pilot projects. And that gave the campaign a really good reason to lodge complaints on actual facts that had already happened with demonstrable damage.
Y estuvimos haciendo acciones jurídicas, demandas, amparos, controversias.
So from that moment on, they started filing legal actions and legal recourses and trying to use to the full extent of the law all these different legal interventions. One through five are examples of those very important national level legal actions.
Y ningún juez no entró al fondo de la, nos fueron rechazadas todas esas.
And each one of these five and others were rejected by the courts. There was no judge who would take our claims.
Pero el año pasado, la próxima, el año pasado, gracias a una acción colectiva, que en México es un instrumento muy nuevo que tenemos desde el 2010,
but something really important happened last year. Really, really important. Probably the most important thing was that the persistence of these people, as well as other environmental groups who have been trying and trying and trying and trying, led to a situation where the constitution of the country had to be changed in order to allow the equivalent of class action lawsuits, which in Mexico didn't exist as a legal figure. So last year was the first time when this was possible, thanks to the work of these people, and they were able immediately to go into that recourse and file a class action lawsuit. Theirs was the third class action lawsuit in the country ever.
Wow.
Es una demanda de acción colectiva en la que nosotros estamos demandando al gobierno de México y a las cuatro principales empresas que son Monsanto, DuPont, Pioneer, Dow AgroScience y Syngenta, porque ellos con esos experimentos han contaminado el maíz nativo.
So we have evidence and we have demonstrable evidence of harm in the sheer contamination of corn. The introduction of open field plantings of corn, whether they're experimental, pilot, or whatever they want to call it, has contaminated corn outside of those fields. And that was used as the cause of action for the court to listen to this claim. And if I may go to the previous slide, please. Thank you. I tell you, I know these slides, huh? They're not mine. This is the plain the defendants are the Mexican government and two agencies within that government. Some agencies within the federal government really are siding with them, but the agriculture agency or agriculture ministry, as well as the natural resources ministry, are not. They're really siding with industry, so they didn't want to listen. So they have been sued as defendants, as well as Monsanto, Pioneer, DuPont, Dow, and Syngenta. And the plaintiffs ¿Quién se queja?
Nos quejamos, somos 53 firmantes, entre los que hay 20 organizaciones campesinas, de indígenas, de apicultores, hay científicos, defensores de derechos humanos.
So the plaintiffs are 53 legal persons, which includes 20 organizations, not individuals, as well organizations of farmers, campesinos, beekeepers and honey producers, as well as human rights defenders, scientists, and other people.
La buena noticia fue que junto a la demanda pedimos una medida cautelar para que suspendiera los cualquier permiso de siembra de transgénicos en lo que el juicio se llevaba de.
And together with the lawsuit, we immediately filed a temporary injunction to stop any planting of any kind of open field corn.
Y la buena noticia es que un juez nos dio esa medida cautelar.
And the great news is that finally a judge has granted this temporary injunction in September of 2015. So at this point, all plantings of corn in Mexico, of GMO corn in Mexico, are stopped. I would like to add, with the freedom of the translator here, from the point of view of someone who is outside of Mexico, I've been out for many years, but I've been engaged with this since the beginning of biotechnology. Every year for the last 15, 20 years, there has been news, and the word was out that Mexico was going to be planted to GMO corn. Every single year, we hear next week, next month, from very good sources, saying it's coming down, and every single year they've been stopped and they've been defeated. Getting better and better and better to the point where now it is legally stopped. Before they were stopped simply by people getting their bodies in front of the trucks and doing all these public actions and so on. Now judges and people in Congress are feeling the heat from the streets and realizing that there is political power to be made and there is also political power to be paid by not listening. So I think it's a really incredible and important cautionary tale or example. Yes.
Could you tell me, please, what is being done, if anything, regarding the NAFTA trade agreements that allow GMO corn to be imported into Mexico?
Yeah. Adelita, la pregunta es qué se está haciendo para prevenir que entre maíz transgénico a México a través de NAFTA, de las importaciones de granos de.
Tú te lo sabes mejor que yo. Pero estamos, en México importa mucho maíz, maíz amarillo, y es maíz transgénico. Eso es una realidad que tenemos, y cuando el doctor Chapela descubrió la contaminación de maíz en México, se hizo un gran estudio de que la contaminación podía ser por el maíz que importábamos. Ese estudio que fue financiado por la Comisión de Cooperación Trinacional con dinero del gobierno de Canadá, Estados Unidos y México, pidió que el maíz se partiera para que perdiera su viabilidad al importarse.
So, starting from the moment when including my lab and the indigenous communities lab that was set up with my help in Oaxaca, when we discovered that Mexican corn was contaminated, there was a really big consternation and hullabaloo and so on, to the point where the NAFTA, the Environmental Office of NAFTA, could not just keep pushing this question aside. So there was a really big meeting, and eventually they had to put about $1 million into a big research project that basically confirmed what we were saying. And at that point, NAFTA said, okay, we need to prevent this grain from being imported because it's the likely source of contamination. The idea is that the grain that is imported into Mexico is imported as grain, not as seed. The difference between grain and seed is something that makes sense for an American farmer, but makes absolutely no sense for a campesino. You eat what you plant, and you plant what you eat, as you saw there.
Mm-hmm.
When you get a corn cob, the woman will look at it and say, wow, this looks pretty good. I think I should put it aside for next year, right? So the difference between seed and grain is non-existent. So NAFTA, the environmental office, said the corn should be cracked to prevent it from germinating. So it should be unviable grain. But
tristemente, no, el gobierno mexicano no ha adoptado esa medida.
But nobody's doing it. Even though it's what they should be doing, nobody's doing it.
Entonces, importamos maíz transgénico. Pero este maíz transgénico entra sobre todo para el alimento de ganado y para la industria.
So most of the importation continues to come in for industrial and feed, cattle feed.
Pero el maíz que se siembra sigue siendo sin transgénicos.
And most of the corn that is planted today, it continues to be planted from the reproduction that farmers follow from year to year, and the consciousness about GMO pollution has made people be more wary of seeds coming in from the outside.
Y entonces tampoco entra en nuestra alimentación cotidiana, ¿no?
So the thought is that there isn't that much going into everyday meals.
Tortillas, tacos, tamales, etc.
I have to say that part of the problem is that the detection of transgenics is very expensive. There is a whole industry, a centralized industry, that has monopolized the detection in business, and they charge, you probably know, $400 a pop to do one determination. So that's a real problem. And when people talk about costs, and here I'm going to talk about your campaign, I know that you're going to be attacked on the economic base. They're going to say it's going to be expensive to enforce this. And they're going to say that they're going to use this. They're going to say it's really expensive to do the testing. And what I say to that, as always, is that the cheapest thing to do is to simply say no.
Yeah.
What is expensive is to coexist. Because if you have them next to you, you have to be testing all the time. If you know they're not there, then you stop worrying and you don't test, and then it becomes really cheap. The problem is to have them in, because then it becomes expensive. Second point I would like to make is that this $400 sample is a completely false and inflated cost that is driven by a monopolistic industry, whether we like the people who are running it or not, because they are really friendly to many organic growers and so on. It's a different problem. The reality is that we can make this detection, at least in my lab, for about 18 cents a pound. And my lab is in Berkeley, is dedicated, and I've been working on this without publishing a thing for 10, 12 years. And we now have a system that we really want to make available to people all over the world, where you can make detections yourself in your hand quickly and incredibly inexpensively. It's not ready to be rolled out, but we are working with especially beekeepers and honey producers as our pilot community. So it won't be ready for this year, probably not even next year. But when they come and tell you that this is expensive, the two answers are, number one, it shouldn't be expensive to detect that much. And what is expensive is to coexist, because you will get contamination, and then you'll have to be following the mouse all over the place.
Bueno, es muy importante lo que Ignacio dice, porque sabemos que Monsanto no va a estar tranquilo con una acción jurídica. Y tenemos mucha sospecha de que está contaminando el maíz en México.
We know that Monsanto is not just going to sit back while they're being prevented from planting transgenic corn in Mexico. And we have very strong suspicions and some evidence that they are intentionally contaminating our fields.
Pero nosotros con gente como Chapela y otros científicos estamos tratando de ver esta contaminación, ir un paso adelante de ellos.
But we are working with independent scientists to try and stay several steps ahead of Monsanto and be ready and be able to deal with this problem.
Y demandar ante el mundo entero que ellos no pueden contaminar el centro de origen y diversificación del maíz.
And in this particular case, we need to make the point and we need to demand at an international scale that centers of origin and diversification of seeds, like the Rogue Valley, I would say, should just be protected internationally.
Y finalmente les quiero mostrar, este es algo que hicimos en 2009, era una reunión del protocolo de Cartagena en México, y decidimos hacer este gran mapa con 35 toneladas de maíz, mismas que recogimos, para decir no al maíz transgénico.
I want to leave you with this image of what is possible. This is an action that we made during a meeting of the United Nations Convention of Biological Diversity in Mexico, and while this was happening, we came out at night, and with a lot of people, we dumped 35 tons of corn to make this map of the country. Those are people, and that's the size of our action. And Adelita will add later on that they picked it all up.
Well, muchas gracias.
Thank you very much.
For being here. We're going to have now some questions and answers, but first I would like to thank Chris Hardy. We have been working with Chris Hardy since 4 years ago. Chris Hardy
started this. For hosting this and allowing us to be here, and I had a little announcement on their behalf. A lot of us have been Grange members off and on in the past, and right now the Bellevue Grange is reconfigured. It's really doing a brand new thing. And actually, we're so proud that all the county Granges have come out and endorsed the ban, which is huge. To get this done, and I want to thank our Family Farms Coalition and Elise Higley and lots of all the volunteers that came out, and we kind of converged and united, and it was really great to feel like we have this coalition already formed and ready to go. So thank you, all of you. And in terms of the Grange, they just wanted me to mention they have 8 scholarships now. So if anybody would like to become a Grange member, they would certainly love to have our energy and our interests back here. So also Chamber of Commons, always is glad to support all of these actions, and we're not going away, but we're just kind of around. So if you want to know more, you can catch us later. Pete, Susie, and I are all here tonight. And some other members too. Thank you so much, everybody. It's really been a great week.
Now we have some questions and answers, but before I want to tell you that we are organizing the 4 Justice Behind with Seeds conference in Portland in September. I want to pass around our mailing list if you want to put out your information, and now you want to coordinate the questions and answers. Thank you so much.
I will coordinate the answers and answers. No questions allowed. Yes, please.
No mice, no ipais. Can you talk a little bit about the Mexican culture and how proud people are to be Mexican and what that means to national sovereignty?
I'm going to let Alida deal with this question because she's dressed more appropriately.
The question
is, could there be some comment about the importance of corn for Mexican culture in general, but specifically the role of corn in the sovereignty for the country.
And the pride in the Mexicans.
And the pride that Mexicans have in their hearts.
In their culture.
Eso es algo muy importante para nosotros. Y por eso a mí me gusta hacer la primera parte de la presentación. Porque...
This is something very, very important for Mexicans. And that's why I always bother to do the first part of this presentation.
Porque el maíz para nosotros es el centro de nuestro corazón, es parte de nuestra cultura, es como lo dice el Popol Vuh, que es un libro sagrado de los mayas, nosotros estamos hechos de maíz.
It's at the center of our heart, there is no question about that, and no matter where you look and how far back you go, you will find in any mythological account of who we are made of corn.
El maíz representa el 55% de la ingesta calórica y 20% de la ingesta proteica de los mexicanos.
And on just simply technical terms, corn represents 55% of calories, calorie intake of the Mexican population, and
20% de las proteínas.
And 20% of protein intake.
Y realmente sin maíz no hay país.
And so really, without corn, there is no country.
Gracias.
Yes, are there any active lawsuits for seed savers like they articulated in Food Inc., where they're suing farmers that have cross-contamination? Are they still being as aggressive as they are? And is there anything going on in Oregon like that?
The question is whether there are any active lawsuits against farmers coming from the industry. And I'm going to deal with this question. And I'm going to deal with it because I would just say, let them dare. Let them dare do it, because I think here in the U.S., there are fewer farmers than there are prisoners, right? And there is no line item in the census to be a farmer anymore. You cannot, there's no line for being a farmer. So it's easy to abuse farmers because they have truly a very small social support. They have huge congressional support and money and so on, but you can beat them around a lot. In Mexico, on the other hand, in a situation where transgenic corn should not be there, legally speaking, to have the cheek to go and sue someone for being contaminated with Monsanto corn would be complete suicide as part of the industry.
No, but in America, what's happening here?
I know, in the U.S. it's happening, but in the U.S. planting GMO corn is legal. And farmers are isolated.
It's an easier
strategy. So they can
strategy.
Get away with it. And the courts are ruling in their favor and so on and so forth. So it's a very different political and legal situation. The fact that these people have prevented the legalization of it, as you guys are pretending to do here, makes, just like with the technical and economic question, if you have a clear boundary, you can say, if you find any here, it's not my fault, it's their fault. Because we have very clear laws. If you open even a little, then you open yourself to all these lawsuits and all this action that is going to be very costly. So again, when people come with how costly it's going to be, you should also bring up, how much is it going to cost the farmers who are going to start suing each other and being sued by Monsanto once it becomes legal to have these plants here. As long as they're illegal, you can say, whoever was responsible for this is going to pay, and that's outside the county. Yes, please.
Do you have any concern in Mexico for the atrazine and Roundup that go with GMOs? And is there any work or legislation against the poisons that go with GMOs?
Yes, they have a
little bit. Si se habla, pero hay un uso.
So there is a big discussion about it, and people do talk about it, even though it is used widely. Roundup is used not together with GMOs, but as a herbicide, as many people use them in urban and suburban environments.
Okay, so we take one more question here. One more.
From your amazing presentation, thank you. It does appear to the novice eye that the large percentage of corn growing is all from the peasant demographic and small family farms. You know, in the United States, that's certainly not the case. We've got millions of acres monocropping and large corporations that we're up against and just large farms. So is it an accurate depiction that most of the corn coming out of Mexico is from these smaller family farms, or do you also have your own domestic and Mexican originated large monocrop acreage, or has that all been infiltrated by American companies? I'm just not very clear on
the corn that's growing here. Alrededor del 60-70% de la producción de maíz tiene de pequeñas superficies.
About 60-70%. The question is whether there is the perception of a huge difference between the U.S. and Mexico, where Mexico production of corn is based on very small family farms and communal farms, as opposed to the U.S., where you have large acreages with single industrial farms. And the question was how much is industrial and how much is small farms. 60-70% in Mexico is small family farms by surface.
O sea, y es un dato reciente.
And it's a very current
y nos vuelve a sorprender.
That we, even ourselves, we are surprised.
Porque son pequeños campesinos.
Because these are small farmers
que no tienen ningún apoyo del gobierno,
who have absolutely no support from the government,
que han sido destinados a que migren a los
who
Estados
are pushed by very well targeted policies to give up their lands and move on and go to the US.
Y siguen produciendo,
and yet they stay there
con
and continue
remesas.
To produce. Many of them subsidized by the money that goes back from workers in the U.S. sending money back to subsidize the production of corn in their local neighborhoods.
Y muchos son mujeres.
Many of them are women, who are the people who are left in these ghost towns. Well, women and children and old people are the only people you see in these towns, and they are the ones who are carrying on the milpa agriculture.
Tenemos otra superficie de grandes superficies en el norte del país como Sinaloa.
The industrial production of corn in Mexico happens mostly in the north, in large areas, in places without too much population, in Sinaloa and Chihuahua and Tamaulipas, Sonora, the northern states.
And so is that where the export is coming from? I mean, it's not the 60-70% of family farms
export to the US.
Export wherever. I mean, is Mexico exporting large amounts of their corn?
No, Mexico used to be a major exporter of corn until NAFTA was signed. And since NAFTA was signed, Mexico started exporting less and less and less, and now it's a very important net importer. That net importer doesn't mean that Mexico doesn't export. Mexico exports high-quality, GMO-free white corn, as opposed to the yellow corn that's produced here. So high-end specialty markets have a premium price for that corn. So there is an amount of that corn that gets exported out of Mexico. But that's vastly offset by the importation of this corn from industrial yellow corn in the U.S.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
So I'd like to introduce Mr. Leno here, Leno de la Rosa Villa. And he's going to give us the last hoorah. And I would just like to again bring gratitude to the Grange here for their tremendous support with technical, with lighting and sound. Richard, thank you so much. I want to make sure that everybody is aware who can stay and help to help bust this out. We just need to get the chairs and everything stacked up and tables folded and put away before we leave here tonight. So it would be much appreciated in our volunteer effort here, as this campaign has been for virtually 2+ years. And we're just grateful that everyone can chip in a hand to make sure we tidy up here for the evening. Thank you.
Thank you for the dishwasher.
So tonight we're going to talk about history. And we're going to talk about what we have to do to win. 32 days to win this election.
So I want to tell you a couple of things. You're going to hear a lot of lies. You know, it's almost funny watching the former sheriff on his tractor saying that they're going to send police out to the farms. The next thing that they're going to say is that the United Nations blue-handed troopers are going to be out on the farms policing everybody. Then they're going to say that this initiative is going to take money from the schools, from the tractors, that because of this initiative, that it'll take away their tractors. It's not going to happen. They're going to say that it's going to bankrupt the county. You know, if they read the resolution or the initiative, they find out that can't happen. But they're going to continue lying. The politics is going to get strong. We're dealing against a monster, a $1 million monster. And you know, and I've been telling you that this is the classic story of David against Goliath, right? And if a woman was writing the Bible, it would be Diana against Goliath. And you know, sometimes Diana can win. And this is one of the cases where Diana can win. You know, I grew up as a farm worker, and I've told this story many times. My mother was sprayed by pesticide, by DDT, while I was still in the womb. And she was sprayed days after, and she worked till the day before I was born, and started to work back 2 days after I was born. DDT and all these pesticides and GMO affect the bodies. So we know what GMO is. Do you know what GMM is? I'm a GMM, I'm genetically modified Mexican. That's really what happens. And you know what, I laugh about it now. We never had sterility in my family till we came to work in the United States and were pressed by and had pesticides put upon us. This happens to a lot of families. Not just sterilities, but abnormalities that come because the womb absorbs everything. The fetus absorbs everything. So you know what we have to do is we have to think about what it takes to win. You know, people are going to tell us that because we have such a giant corporation, such giant people fighting us, that we can't win. But you know, the history that you made in Mexico with campesinos, with ecologists, with environmentalists, with organizations that want to save Mexico, this has happened in this country. Women's suffragette movement, women had to suffer to get the right to vote. When we started the environmental movement, and those of you who are old enough to remember the peace movement, they told us we couldn't stop the war in Vietnam. And we did. And we stopped it. It wasn't the politicians. It was people that went out on the streets. You know, it takes us. You know, I worked with Cesar Chavez as an organizer in the farm fields and the farm workers. They said, what is this little Mexican going to do to organize farm workers and win contracts against the big growers, and Dow Chemical was supporting them, and Monsanto and the other ones. And you know who helped them? Was ordinary farm workers standing up, and people in the cities who joined in on the boycott of grapes and lettuce. And a lot of you did that. And a lot of you were part of that victory. So you know what a victory is. And we know what Martin Luther King did in order to get his victory. We know what Nelson Mandela and the ANC did to get their victory. It started out with a few people, but people that were determined. We're in the place where we can make history. This is a place where we can turn the tide. So that in the books later on, they're going to talk about Jackson County. Jackson County. Jackson County is going to turn the page. It's going to turn the page when they talk about GMOs, when they talk about Syngenta and the others. They're going to say, Jackson, it started in Jackson County. This is where you are. You're going to be the heroes and the heroines. This is where legends are written. And you know what? And I've seen it in this campaign. I've seen it in the people who came and worked from the outside and helped us. You know, Miguel, who came from the Bay Area and brought all these wonderful speakers, is that people want to make a difference. You know, one of my heroes, Martin Luther King, told us that it really doesn't matter how long we live. You know, he would tell us that, and I would think about it. He would say, if you know, it really doesn't matter how long you live, but what you did when you were alive. You know, longevity has its place. We all want to live a long life. But you know, it really doesn't matter how long you live, how powerful your friends were, if you didn't do anything with that power. It really doesn't matter how much education you got, if you didn't do anything with that education. It really doesn't matter how long you lived, but what you did when you were alive. And then, you know, it's not the promises we make, but the promises we keep. We're always making promises that we don't keep. I'm going to friend you on Facebook. We're going to have coffee. I'll see you at the Grange. Make promises that we don't keep. Here's a great one. I'll love you forever. We're always making promises that we don't keep. But there is a promise that we've all made to each other. A promise that we've made and we've got to keep. That promise is to the family farmers, it's to the Rogue Valley, it's to the people in Mexico, it's to each other, that we're going to win. And we're going to keep that promise. And come May 20th will be the fruits of our labors. We can't stop now. We have promises to keep. Brent.